Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. I am your instructor today. And I will be discussing the topic, fuel injection. This topic is taken from STCW function, function 1 marine engineering at the operational level. Competence, operation, surveillance, performance assessment, and maintaining safety of propulsion plant and auxiliary machinery. TOP, which is knowledge, understanding, and proficiency. The efficient operation, surveillance, performance, assessment, and maintaining safety of propulsion plant and auxiliary machinery. We have here the learning outcome at the end of this lesson. The student should be able to explain the atomization and penetration of fuel and turbulence of air. Describe with the aid of the simple sketches the difference between constant and variable injection timing of fuel. Showing materials, principal parts. Identify common service faults, symptoms, and causes of combustion problems. Specifying appropriate adjustment, including method of fuel pump timing. Discuss the atmospheric pollution aspects of diesel engine combustion and give methods which reduce this pollution, especially SOx or sulfur oxide, NOx, nitrogen oxide reduction. So we have here the introduction. Efficient combustion of fuel oil inside the engine. Cylinder is an important aspect for the overall engine efficiency. The process of fuel combustion depends on many subdivided processes which are together contribute to the engine efficiency. A good combustion of fuel oil can easily be identified from a clear exhaust of the engine. The total output power and the exhaust temperature of temperature. Any variation of these parameters indicates that there is some problem in the fuel combustion. General indication of improper combustion are an even running of engine, variation in engine speed, and knocking sound from cylinders or fuel system. So we have here the main parts of fuel combustion process are correct viscosity, atomization, penetration, and turbulence. So in a diesel engine, however, fuel in the form of small particles is sprayed into the cylinder after air has been compressed. Thus, mixing takes place with the cylinder. If each particle of fuel is to be surrounded by sufficient air to burn it completely, that is proper air-fuel mixture is to be obtained. The air in the combustion space must be in a motion. In motion, so this air motion is called turbulence. So we have here. So the viscosity, so as you can see here, this is a simulation of a liquid with different viscosities. The liquid on the right has higher viscosity, this one, than the liquid on the left. So as you can see here, this is flowing fast compared to this liquid. This is thick, this is thin. So this is higher viscosity than this liquid. So penetration is the turbulence traveled by the fuel particle inside the combustion chamber just before burning. Atomization and penetration of processes other is the correct fuel injector and injection system is required for proper penetration of fuel. So this is atomization. So as you can see here, this is just like almost air, but together with the fuel. So this is spray penetration, atomization. So penetration is the distance traveled by the fuel particle. So from here, the injector going to the inside of the cylinder. So it occupies the distance traveled. So that is penetration. So we have here the correct viscosity. Controlling the viscosity of fuel oil is the first step towards the Efficient combustion, viscosity or resistance to flow needs to be kept in proper limits to ensure correct atomization at the fuel injector. Viscosity can be reduced by increasing the temperature of the fuel oil. So exact viscosity can be adjusted using viscosity regulator and the fuel heaters. Fuel oil viscosity is ideally adjusted at 15 CST at 50 degrees Celsius before atomization. So as you can see here, you have a heater and you have fuel oil inlet and you have fuel oil outlet here. So here is the three-way valve. So yeah, this is either pneumatic or electrically operated. So as you can see here, there is a relay viscosity alarm. So this is a controller here. So whatever the temperature here will send the signal to the controller, and the controller will send signal to the actuator here on the bulb, automatic bulb. So this one will open. So more viscosity here will open the steam, more steam to the heater. So that the fuel oil will be heated up to 125 to 135 degrees Celsius normally. So 120 is still good, but normally 125 to 135 fuel oil temperature. So to reduce the viscosity of the fuel oil needs the fuel oil heater. Atomization is a process of breaking down of the fuel into minute droplets with the help of fuel injector. So here. So fuel oil is pressurized through tiny holes in the injector, which splits the fuel into small droplets. So these atomized droplets have a higher surface to mass ratio, which helps a good heat transfer from hot compressed air to the oil droplets, resulting in rapid evaporation. So as you can see here, here is the injector, so the nozzle tip. So it's spraying fuel oil. So as you can see, this is very good atomization. So almost air, you see, almost air. So the fuel is being spray, being atomized inside the cylinder by means of the injector. So the size of the droplets depends on the size of the holes and the pressure difference between the pump discharge and the compressed air inside the cylinder. This means that the sizes of the droplets will vary at the different areas inside the cylinder. So inside the cylinder. Penetration, it can be referred as the distance the atomized particles traveled from the injector into the combustion space of the cylinder. So before the actual mixing, evaporation and ignition takes place, penetration depends on the size of the atomized particles, their velocities and condition inside the combustion chamber. So yeah, so penetration is the distance traveled by the fuel particles inside the combustion chamber just before burning. So atomization, penetration opposite each other, hence the correct fuel injector injection system is the required for proper penetration of fuel. So here we have a special care is taken in order to spread the particles evenly inside the combustion space without touching the internal surfaces. So before the actual combustion occurs, the spray pattern is decided by the number, size and position of atomizer holes. So here. So we have here the turbulence. So it's the movement given a mixture of the compressed air and the fuel droplets inside the cylinder. So this is particularly done to increase the maximum capability of fuel and air and also to facilitate rapid combustion. So turbulence is a kind of swirl that is provided to the air in its entry at the scavenging ports. So fuel spray pattern along with the turbulence provide an ideal ground for efficient combustion. So sure can be generated with the help of the design of the shape of the piston. So at the top of the piston there is a the curve shape there. So turbulence is extremely important for rapid combustion of heavy fuel and diesel engine. So in a diesel engine, however, fuel oil in the form of small particles spray into the cylinder after the air has been compressed. So thus mixing takes place within the cylinder. So if each particle of fuel is to be surrounded by the sufficient air to burn it completely, so that is the proper air fuel air mixture. Air fuel mixture is to be obtained. So the air in the combustion space must be motion. So the air motion is called turbulence. So here we will proceed at the variable injection timing or BIT in fuel pumps. So for a simple jerk type fuel pump, start of fuel injection is at fixed at the point which the top of the plunger covers spill port. So end of injection, which is variable, takes place when the edge of the helix uncovers the spill port. So variable injection timing or BIT is the term used to define the fuel injection pump which alters the timing of the start of fuel injection. So we have here now the chart. So we jerk type injection pump. This can be done by following methods. So by altering the position of the barrel with respect to the plunger, so using fuel pump with two plungers, altering the fuel cam or cam follower position, or by using specially designed fuel pumps such as saucer fuel pumps. So BIT is employed to advance fuel injection timing so that maximum combustion pressure or Pmax is reached at about 85% load. So this gives a more efficient engine by lowering the fuel consumption. So see the diagram. Here we have the chart. So here as you can see, 40%, 85% and 100%. So fuel index. So here at 85%, with BIT index, so without BIT here, so the Pmax. So as you notice here, without BIT, the Pmax is you see, a straight line. So meaning the Pmax here is steady. But with BIT, it can be higher. So you see, can be higher with BIT. So especially here at 100%, you see. So 85% to 100%. So with BIT, you see. So additional 15% more. So here, the figure above shows variation of Pmax for fuel pump with BIT, shown in a red line, and without BIT shown in the dotted red line. Variation of fuel index and BIT index is also shown. So action of BIT starts at 40 of the engine load. From this load, start of fuel injection is advanced to increase the Pmax gradually as the engine load reaches 85%. So value of Pmax will be corresponding to 100% unload of the engine. So see in the picture. So from 85% load, start of fuel injection retards to keep the Pmax constant. So from the figure, BIT index shows advance and retard of fuel injection. So as you can see here, from 85, you see. So without BIT, so the Pmax is only here, you see. But with BIT, the Pmax is, you see, at around 100% low, the Pmax is higher, you see, with BIT, variable injection timing. So here we have the Injection timing can also be manually adjusted to allow for more efficient combustion of fuels with different ignition qualities. So hence, the purpose of BIT on the ships are improve the specific fuel consumption or spoke of the engine, optimizing the combustion process of different quality of fuels. So as you can see here, so this one is advanced timing. So this delivery and this is suction. So here, as you can see, in the real engine, if there is a BIT of the injection pumps, you can see two fuel racks. So this advanced timing, as you can see, this is connected to the what we call the suction, the suction. So more suction supply of fuel by controlling of the BIT, more fuel supply. So without the BIT, so as you can see the graph earlier that I show to you, so the Pmax is steady, but if there is a BIT, which is variable injection timing, the Pmax is increasing to 100% because of the suction, more suction of fuel is also more delivery of fuel. So here, so we don't need to discuss this one further. Just read this one. So the quantity of the fuel delivered can be controlled by altering the position of the eccentric pivot of the spill valve lever. So this will cause the spill valve to open earlier or later. So by altering the position of the suction valve pivot, so the start of the injection can be controlled, and therefore it can be seen that the pumps utilizes BIT. So as you can see here, if there is BIT, this one will give more suction of fuel, and because of there is more suction of fuel, there is more delivery of fuel. So this can create additional Pmax. The injection timing can also be manually adjusted to allow for more efficient combustion of fuels with different ignition qualities. So hence, the purpose of BIT ships are, so I think this is already, so we move forward here. So improve the specific fuel consumption of the engine, optimizing the combustion process of different quality of fuels. So we have here, what is injection timing? So we will discuss this one. So injection timing is the timing of the when fuel is injected into the cylinder. So which alters when the combustion takes place. The time of when the fuel is injected can be altered to be injected at different points and times. So the manufacturer when engine does recommend a certain timing, which is the timing, you set it at when the engine is first made. This timing is usually balanced to get as much power as possible. So while still remaining in legal limits of emission, adjusting injection pump is also often referred to as spill timing. So this is a engine timing diagram. So why adjust injection timing? Usually injection timing is adjusted to create more power in the engine. So this is the purpose. So it can be advanced to create more power. Sometimes timing is adjusted to opposite direction to fix a smoking or lag problem. So can injection timing be adjusted on a diesel engine? So young or old timing can be adjusted in the engine. So the only difference is how the timing will be adjusted, which covers covered later on this topic. So here, diesel engine injection time adjustment. So we have advanced. So advanced time is by engine means that you are moving combustion up. Time up in time. So in other words, you are adjusting the timing so that ignition happens earlier than with the manufacturer originally set to occur. So no need to just read this statement here. So usually the location is measured in degrees. For example, 10 degrees bottom dead center is when the crankshaft is 10 degrees before the piston is at its highest point. So in the cycle, in case you can figure out degrees just by looking at the crankshaft. So I had a problem before in my shipment engine. So actually it was already have a problem of surging even before when I was not there on the ship. But I found out that the timing from the Mikros manual was 4.5, so degrees before tap dead center. But the timing I found out that it was 7 and 8 before tap dead center. So I retime again. I put it in 5 degrees before tap dead center. So the problem of engine turbo charger surging was gone. So it was the injection pump timing problem. So here retarding. So retarding the timing when is essentially the opposite of the advance. It is when you adjust timing so that ignition occurs after manufacturer's original spread time. So people will retard the ignition timing of their engines for various reasons, although it is less common. Some of these reasons are fuel economy and performance. So the rest of this article. So for me, I don't like the late timing or retard timing. I don't like the advanced timing because it causes problem. I like the normal timing, so I prefer the normal timing. So how to adjust injection timing? So there are several ways you can adjust injection timing depending on the type of the engine you have and how old it is. So the most common ways to adjust injection timing are programming the ECM, so electronic control module. So I experienced also this ECM when I was working with the Caterpillar. So the governor is ECM instead of mechanical governor. It is using electronic control module. So adjusting of the fuel injection pump. So replacing camshaft and replacing the cam pullers or gasket. So programming the ECM. So just read this one, so no need to discuss. So fuel injection pump. So one of the easier ways to mechanically adjust engine timing is to adjust the fuel injection pump. So I did this before. So this is as simple as rotating the pump in the engine. So rotating the pump requires just a screwdriver and socket wrench. So it's most especially have a for the bigger injection pumps, you have to use the of course the spanner you have to use, not just the screwdriver. So camshaft, another way to adjust timing is to replace with camshaft. So just read this one. So cam followers also cheaper option for changing when the valves and injectors are triggered is replacing the camshaft followers or gasket. Advantages and disadvantages of advanced timing. So advantages, people, advanced timing. So there have to be a good reasons for missing with it, right? So yes, advanced the timing will usually increase the amount of power your engine produces. that are also usually invest the fuel economy. So the original, so this is written from the book, but I don't believe this based on my actual experience, because the advanced timing, the effect of the engine is the turbocharger will always have a surging. So my engine before, my main engine was set in advanced timing, but the turbocharger always surging. So I put it in normal timing, as well specified in the manufacturer's manual. So it was the surging of the turbocharger was gone. So I don't like that advanced timing. So just read this one. So diesel engine. So I don't like also retard timing or retard timing, because I found out that there is a higher exhaust temperature in the retard timing and low power. So I don't like the retard timing and I don't like the advanced timing. I prefer to have a normal timing. So normal injection timing. So here, so here this is engine combustion problem. So as you can see here, very smoky. See, okay. So this is not allowed. Probably the authority of that area, that place will cut the bezel or will give fine, because this is violating the MARPOL 6 air pollution. So a black smoke, so this is the most common and common one, and is really just an imbalance in the air to fuel ratio. So too much fuel to not enough air. So too much fuel, this is the result of too much fuel, but there is not enough air. So this means either too much fuel being added to the mix, or there's not enough oxygen being supplied to burn the fuel. So black smoke is all particulates that are basically large diesel particles that normally would be burned as fuel. So most common causes of black smoke are faulty injectors, faulty injection pump, a bad air filter causing not enough oxygen to the supplied to be supplied, or even the bad turbocharger. So in other words, too much fuel and lack of air can cause black smoke, because of it is hard to burn. It is incomplete combustion. Here also we have a white smoke. So in my experience here, in the white smoke, the intake valve of the engine was broken. Intake valve. So white smoke means that the fuel that is being injected into the combustion chamber is not being burned properly. So the common cause is that white smoke range from something as simple as low engine compression, so loss compression, or water in the fuel to the fuel pump. So timing being thrown up, being because something is starving the fuel from getting to the pump. So in the manner necessary for the pump to time and work correctly. So during my time, I experienced this my time in the ship, no? So I experienced this white smoke. I found out that the intake valve was broken. So the intake valve was the seating of the intake valve was had a bigger cut, so causing the cylinder causing loss compression. So that's why there is a lot of white smoke. So we have also here blue smoke, as you can see here. So, blue smoke results from burning engine oil. So, as you can see here, the piston rings, the oil rings is damaged. So, this is a mechanical problem because engine oil isn't supposed to be getting into the areas where it can be burned. So, there could be a faulty injection pump. So, or leak pump, which would allow the oil to mix with fuel and be burned. So the bulbs or bulb stem cells could be bad. So worn cylinders and piston rings. So remember the causes. It might be the injection pump or leak pump faulty. So there is a leaking of oil. So it can be also the so the fuel, the oil is mixed with the fuel, so the it is burn inside the cylinder, so it causes the blow smoke with the bulbs also, or bulb stem cells. So the bulb stem cells also of the intake and exhaust bulbs is leaking, so the oil is mixing to the fuel. So we have here what is SOx and NOx. So the two main pollutants from ships emissions are nitrogen oxides, NOx, and sulfur oxide, SOx. Both NOx and SOx are combustion products that are emitted in the environment in the form of smoke. So MARPOL Annex 6 is strictly followed to have the air pollution under the control limits. So we have here following are the methods to reduce NOx emission from the ship. So we have here the humid air method. So just read here, humid air method. So by the way, so in this method, water vapor is mixed in the combustion chamber, air before supplying it on the cylinder. So air from the turbocharger blower is passing through a seal that humidifies and chills the hot air, taking moisture from the cooling water until air saturation is achieved. So generally, saline seawater is utilized in this method by heating it with the jacket water and turbocharger heat, and the leftover brine is disposed back to the sea. So this method achieves reduction of NOx by 70 to 80%. So this method, humid air method, can reduce the NOx or nitrogen oxide by 70 to 80%. So we have also here the EGR, exhaust gas recirculation. So as the same as the name suggests, some amount of the engine exhaust are sent back to the scavenging space to mix up with the air to be supplied to the cylinder for combustion. So this reduces the oxygen content of the air and hence reduces formation of NOx. So as you can see here, so this is EGR, so diesel engine. This is EGR bulb. So this EGR bulb. So the exhaust of the engine, when this EGR bulb opens, so it will pass to the EGR cooler and it is supplied again to the intake of the engine. So EGR intake throttle here supplied engine. So this the way also of reducing NOx. Water injection and water circulation. So in this method, water is added to reduce temperature of the combustion, leading to low NOx emission. So in water emulsion, fuel is blended with water in a water injection separate fresh water. Injection is mounted in the cylinder head, which injects water. So this method has a drawback of increasing the specific fuel oil combustion with a reduction in NOx by only to 20 to 45%. So you have water bulb here and fuel needle. So control unit, solenoid bulb, so water tank, pressure transformer. So it is, as you can see here, it is also mixed with a water emulsion to the fuel. So it is blended. High scavenge pressure and combustion ratio. So with high scavenging pressure and compression ratio, large amount of air can be introduced inside the cylinder to lower combustion temperature and NOx emission. We have also here selective catalytic reduction. So this is the system. So the ECR is the most efficient and method to reduce NOx emission from ships. So up to 90 to 95% of reduction. So in this method, low sulfur fuel is used and exhaust temperature is maintained at 300. So the exhaust gas is mixed with the water solution of urea and then it is passed through catalytic reactor. So the only disadvantage of ECR is it's expensive. So why this is expensive? Expensive installation and operating cost. So this is the system. So there are two stages of turbocharger, EBB. It is two-stage turbocharger that can reduce also exhaust temperature in the intercoolers and also the NOx content in the emitted exhaust. So this one EBB. So here we have engine component modification. So it's better to design an engine which has a property to reduce the NOx formation during combustion. So process rather than investing an expensive secondary measures. So integration of the slide bulb type fuel injector with almost zero suck. Volume eliminates any chance of fuel dripping and after burning leading to cylinder temperature and NOx formation. So engine component modification. We have also here SOx, sulfur oxide, reducing SOx emission. SOx or sulfur oxides are formed during combustion process in the engine because of the presence of sulfur content in the fuel. So the fuel must be in low sulfur. So as you can see here, the data, so this is worldwide fuel sulfur content limits. So prior January 1 January 2012, so it was the sulfur content of the fuel was 4.5%. So this is worldwide. And after January 1 or 1 January 2012, so it was reduced to 3.5%. So during my time, this is the fuel is supplied with sulfur content not more than 3.5%. After January 2020, so it is reduced to 0.5%. So in emission control areas, Baltic Sea area, North American area, United States, Caribbean Sea area, North Sea area. So prior January, so in this special area, emission ECA, emission control areas. So prior 1 July 2010, the sulfur content must be 1.5. So after July 2010, it was reduced to 1.0. So after January 2015, it was reduced to 0.1. So following are the methods and technologies used to reduce sulfur emission from marine engines. So use of low sulfur fuel oil. So it is expensive, but most commonly used method to comply with the Annex 6 of MARPOL while entering emission controlled area or ECA. So heavy fuel oil are referred to as low sulfur fuel oil, LSFO. So if their sulfur content is below 1%, usually these are marine fuel types IFO 180 or IFO 380, which had been desulfurized until the end of 2014. Ships could be still traveled through emission control areas ECAS with this type of marine fuel. So this is marine fuel. So we have here also here the exhaust gas scrubber. So the exhaust gas from the engine is passed through the scrubber tower where a liquid is showered over it. So fresh water blended with caustic soda is used as the scrubbing liquid, which reduces the SOx to 95%. So the scrubbing water is then sent to a water treatment fuel emulsion breaking plant, after which it can be discharged overboard. So scrubbers or exhaust gas cleaning system, EGCS, are used to remove particulate matter and harmful components such as sulfur oxides and nitrogen oxides from the exhaust gas generated as a result of combustion process in the marine engines to implement pollution control. So here you have the scrubber exhaust, so exhaust in. Let's so you have the seawater here. So seawater is injected, as you can see, and it is after here. So it is flowing to the water treatment, wash water treatment, and going back to overboard. So the residue is separated here. We have also here cylinder lubrication. Good quality of cylinder lubrication along with efficient control systems such as pulse and ABLA alpha lubricator. So this one can alpha lubrication system can neutralize the sulfur in the fuel and reduce SOx emission from the engine. That is alpha lubricator. So for the recap, we have discussed the following: the atomization and the penetration of fuel and the turbulence of air, the difference between constant and variable injection timing of the fuel sewing materials, principal parts, common service faults, symptoms and causes of combustion problems, specifying appropriate adjustment including methods of fuel pump, the atmospheric pollution aspects of diesel engine combustion and give methods which are reduced pollution, especially SOx and NOx reductions. So what to do next meeting, or after the next meeting, we have a short quiz for a given discussion, and we have also an oral recitation. Then after that, we will discuss the following: so the working principles of turbochargers, lubrication and cooling requirements of the turbochargers, the typical faults, and identify appropriate actions to be undertaken with defective or damaged turbochargers. So that will be our activity for the next meeting. So I will end this video for now, and please subscribe my channel. Please click notification bell. Please click like and share, and thank you for watching, and see you on my next video.